Let's start. So my name is Thomas Blazer. I'm a PhD student at the Software Languages Lab located here at university. So in this talk, I will describe a way to detect security vulnerabilities in event-driven scheme programs by means of data analysis. And as the title indicates, it's a static data analysis, which means that we are going to do this at compile time, and so without running or executing the program. And actually, this work is the result of my master thesis, and Carl Daniels are my advisors sitting over there. And Kuhn is my promoter, which is at the moment not here. So before I'm going to introduce the concept of data analysis, I was wondering whether some of you already know what data analysis is. And if so, could you please raise your hand if you know? Okay, that's nice. Okay, so data analysis. Data analysis is simply a data flow analysis that is able to detect two kinds of violations in the program. Violations against program integrity, so for example, untrusted inputs such as user inputs flows from the query. This query executes and suddenly all your tables are gone, so you don't want that. So another one that it can detect is violations of confidentiality of information. So for example, a password that is leaked outside of the program, you also don't want to do that. So on this slide, there is an example like that. So the way that data analysis defines those problems is in terms of sources, sinks, and sanitizers. So first of all, source. A source is any origin of taint in a program. And in this case, we consider the variable password to be tainted because it contains confidential information. The second one is sink. So sink is any location in the program where taint is not allowed to flow to. So in case this happens, so in case there is a flow from a source to a sink, then there is a violation, and this violation will be detected by the taint analysis. Now finally, sanitizer. So a sanitizer is able to convert tainted values to become untainted. If we analyze this program, we see that it's an if-state if expression, and that there are two possible ways to execute the program. So the first flow from the source to the sanitizer and then to the sink is alright, because we're going from tainted to untainted and then to a sink which is allowed. But of course the other one is not allowed, because we're flowing directly from a source to a sink. So tainted values flowing to a sink is not allowed and is a violation. So as I indicated in the titles, what we want to do is particular for event-driven programs, and the difference with sequential programs is of course that they listen to events and they react to events. And typically this behavior is defined in so-called event listeners or event handlers, and so those are registered for a specific event and on a specific object. So in this example, whenever a key press event occurs, the sequence string will be assigned to the key. Now difference or property of event-driven programs is that there is no explicit flow between event listeners. So it's not clear from the program which event listener is called after which one, because it's simply not clear and it's determined by external sources like users and stuff like that. So we have an implicit control flow between them. And this actually brings us to the problem. So in this case, we have three event listeners that each manipulate the key in some way or use it. And if we look, there is indeed a violation because we are assigning tainted values to key flows to the sink, so that's a violation. And that is that should be detected by the taint analysis, but because there is an implicit flow between those, static data analysis cannot predict how the flows go, how the flows are, and just this leak remains undetected. So static analysis needs explicit flows in the program, and this is not the case with event-driven programs. So in order to detect this leak, we have to compute the behavior of the program in general, and of course be sure that the behavior of the event listeners and the flow is included in the total approximation. So to do that, we are using abstract interpretation. So abstract interpretation is a static analysis technique. More specifically, we are going to use the approach of Van Doren and Mind, which we will explain in a second. But to get the idea of abstract interpretation, so concrete interpretation is simply the interpretation that we know. So given an interpreter and a program, the interpreter will step by step through the program. So actually we're going from one program state to another program state. And if we do this for a complete program, we get a linear trace of execution states. Now the problem is that these traces might be infinite. And of course we want our analysis to terminate even for non-termination programs. Another problem is that those traces are for individual executions of the program. So the approach from Van Doren and Light describe a way to systematically convert concrete semantics to abstract semantics. And the idea is then when you execute your program using those abstract semantics, that you get a so-called abstract state graph, which includes every possible program behavior, and it's also determined to be finite. So that is exactly what we want, but of course there is a trade-off to be done, and trade-off is precision in this case. But although some precision is lost to get the finiteness, we are sure that whenever a program would end up in a specific state in the program, that this state will be included somewhere in this graph, and that is what we want. So I said that the result of abstract interpretation is an abstract state graph, so don't really worry about the contents of the nodes, but every node is, in this case, an abstract program state, and does not include any inventory behavior yet, which will be added later. But the interesting part are the error states in this example, in this graph. And why? Because during abstract interpretation, the data analysis will track all the flows from sources to sinks. And whenever there is a violation, it will generate this kind of error states in the graph. So when we want to find all possible leaks in the program, we simply have to query this graph to find all those states, and we know where the source and where the sink is located. For the implementation itself, we use an abstract interpretation framework developed by a fellow PhD student, which was my advisor as well. And it allows us to generate those kind of abstract state graphs for a specific sequential programming scheme. But of course, we are going to extend it to be able to analyze event-driven programs. So first of all, the language. So the framework already supports a basic subset of scheme. And we are going to extend that with three expressions that allows us to mark where source is, where sink is, where sanitizer is. And that will enable the analysis, so the data analysis, to determine whether there is a leak or not. And then also we extend it with objects because we can trigger events on a specific object. And we are inspired by JavaScript. As you can see, there are two different kinds of properties. The difference is that here you have to specify an explicit getter and setter, so it enables side effects. And of course, the basic operations to access update and delete. And then finally, the interesting part, so we have expressions to register or unregister event listeners for a specific event on an object and the event listener. A way to create events for a specific event type, so this might be, for example, egress. And then the last two I will explain in a minute in one of the next slides. So given that we have our language, we have a way to create events, we have a way to register them, but we still miss the connection between them. We still need a way to process externally triggered events in order that it looks up the specified for the registered event listeners and execute them in the registration order. So we are still following the semantics of JavaScript for this. So we introduce a get queue similar to how it works in JavaScript. So the way that this queue works, during the execution of a program, externally triggered events will be scheduled into the queue. And when your program, when the call cycle of your program is empty or there are no executions left to execute, it will take the first event out of the queue, it will look up its registered event listeners and execute it. And this process continues indefinitely because event-driven programs usually don't end. So given that we have our language, we have the semantics, we are going back to the static analysis. So remember that there was an implicit flow between event listeners. So there is no explicit flow that the static analysis can follow between all these event listeners. And that costs the analysis to miss particular leaks in the program. Now, a naive or straightforward solution is to schedule every possible event in any order in order to get an explicit flow between all those event listeners. And that will eventually allow our analysis to detect all the leaks in the program. And this approach is used in those two JavaScript analysis schemes. But the problem with this is that it's computationally expensive because we're trying every possible combination and exploring all possible behavior, including spurious behavior. And for larger programs, you can imagine that this becomes too expensive to compute. So our approach instead is inspired by Matsen et al. That is a model-based approach. So we use those emit statements, or emit expressions, sorry, to indicate which events can occur at a specific time. And if you look at this specific example, so here, in this program, we're stating that that at the beginning of the program, only a key press event can occur. Then after a key press, every event can occur in any order. Here, after clear, we can have key press and clear. And then finally, we say that whenever the same event occurs, the program terminates. So by doing this, so using a kind of model, the analysis is, of course, able to more precisely detect those leaks because it's avoiding spurious event sequences. And that is, of course, what we want. We want to detect more precise event sequences that lead to a particular link. So the small expression here at the bottom, the event queue is simply to indicate that, okay, at this point the program, the call stack is empty and we are starting the event queue. So it will see that the first event in the event queue is key press, it will start executing them and then see which other ones are scheduled and continue until a fixed point is reached. So if we do this, or the naive approach, what do we get? We do get an abstract event graph in this case, but that's again the abstract state graph from before, but included with annotations at which moment an event was triggered, and it also includes the flows of event listeners. So now we are able to detect leaks in event driven programs, but it also brings or arises another problem. And the problem is that while we know there is a leak, we know where the source is, where we know where the sink is, but we still want to know which sequence of events led to that specific leak. So that's the manual inspection. So we don't want, as a developer, to manually inspect this graph to find which event sequence has to be triggered in order for that leak to occur. So the second contribution of this work is actually automatically generating regular expressions that denote or describe which events has to be triggered in order for a specific leak to occur. So to do so, we actually start by maybe obvious observation, which is that this graph is actually an automaton, and mainly an deterministic one. And that's, of course, the alphabets are the event types. Now, Now, to convert this to regular expressions, we can do this actually in three steps. The first step is to remove intermediate states. So as you can see, there are a lot of states from event listeners or from functions that actually do not matter in this case, so we can simply remove them to reduce, which will of course reduce the graph in a significant way. The second step then is to convert this graph to a minimal deterministic finite animator. And that is done in order to finally convert the DFA to regular expressions. So that's a three-step process that is well known to convert an NFA to regular expressions. So for the example, what do we get? In this case, we get two regular expressions. Why? Because the abstract event graph contains two different error states. For each error state, we are going to compute a regular expression that describes which event sequences lead to that particular loop. And besides the regular expressions, we also provide the shortest one. And why? Because ideally, you want to find the bug or the leak as fast as possible. And if you are able to solve the leak for this specific event sequence, it might also solve for every other sequence. And for this example, of course, the shortest event sequence is the same, but in general that might not be the case because you can have two different event sequences that lead to the same leak. So that's why we provide both of them. Okay, so just to recap, so we are able to detect leaks in event-driven programs, and we also are able to summarize the possible event sequences that lead to that particular leak. So finally, for the evaluation. So for the evaluation, since we have our own language, we decided to write programs where the essence of particular leaks are modeled. So we take existing JavaScript programs or benchmarks, we look at them, we identify the particular leak, how it occurs, we model that particular leak, only the essence of it in our programs. As you can see, they are quite small because we're only modeling the essence of the leak. So to assess our analysis, we decide to measure the precision recall and accuracy. So first of all, the recall is 100%, which means that our analysis is sound for these benchmarks. So this is able to detect all possible leaks that are inside the program. And if you look at the formula, you have false negatives are zero, which means that there are no leaks that are left undetected. Then for the precision, it's rather low, you might say, but there is a reason for it, and that is because we only have two programs where there is indeed a leak. But if you look at the formula, the true positives might be at most two, but the false positives might be at most six, so you're dividing two by six, which gives you a rather small percentage. So the accuracy is actually a better metric. Why? Because it takes the false negatives into account. So false negative is there is no leak in the program and the analysis correctly detects that there is no leak. And well, as you can see, it's significantly better and gives us a good impression of our analysis. And as a last experiment, we used context sensitivity to improve the results. So I'm not sure if anyone knows what CFA or KCFA is, but remember that in the abstract interpretation, we traded off some precision to get a finite abstract graph. And because of this trade-off, it might be that there are flows merged. But with context sensitivity, you use some kind of history to be able to distinguish between those different flows. And because of there are now two flows instead of one, it is able to well, to compute more precise facts, and then it might be able to figure out that there is indeed no leak instead of this. If zero, it's, for example, detected that there may be a leak, but with one CFA, it's sure that there is no leak. So context sensitivity in general is a way to improve the precision of your analysis. So we are already, well, this is what I didn't tell yet. So for two examples, it is unable to detect that there are no leaks. So there are no leaks in this program, although our analysis says that is indeed the case, or might, well, might be the case. So it's clear that KCFA didn't help in this case, and the reason is because, well, the obvious reason is that there weren't any functions in the program itself, or that there, or that the imprecision of the analysis wasn't related to, well, wasn't related to anything to do with functions, because KCFA in specific is able to distinguish flows to the same function. Okay, so we are reached our conclusion. So remember that I introduced a way to detect leaks in event-driven scheme programs. The problem originated from the fact that there is an implicit flow between those event listeners, and that the static analysis is not able to see those flows between them, so it needs explicit flows. So we started from a naive approach where we just trigger every event in every order, and this allows us to indeed detect those leaks, but this computation is expensive. So we instead opted for a model-based approach, which is of course more precise and avoids the exploration of spurious event sequences. And if we do this, we get the abstract event graph, but remember, as a developer, you don't want to inspect this graph, but you want to get a summary of all possible event sequences that lead to a particular leak. And this is what we have done indeed. And as a last, well, for the evaluation, we simply modeled the essence of particular leaks and computed the precision, the accuracy, and the recall for the rest. So that's my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions, anyone? Yes.
If I, as a programmer, forget to emit or put emit the expression at some point in my code, and I use a model-based approach, and it happens that I do not find the
leak. Well, the approach is only as precise as your model. I think that's with any kind of model-based approach. If your model is wrong, then you get wrong results. So, yeah.
That's true. Yes, you mentioned that you used the Rostovsky approach for creating the snake machine. Did you actually use Rostovsky's work, or did you use the modern interpretation of his work?
Well, I used the library for it, so it was already implemented. But it was based on the paper of 62. Yeah,
and we're reading that sure. Because there's the Brzozowski's paper is the correct canonical version. But there's another version by somebody named Owen, I forget his first name, but he's reformulated Brzozowski's work in modern language, and it's much more pleasant to read.
Well, I'm not sure about that. It should be, well, it's originally based on the guy's algorithm.
Yeah. Related to that, I was not sure if I picked up on how you got the minimal event sequence. Is it related to the state machine minimization?
Well, the shortest event sequences can be derived from just looping over the automator to find finite state or an end state.
Okay. I think I might just need to look at
it. Well, I didn't explain it explicitly, but the three-step process just gives us the regular expressions. So, besides that, we also have to go through the short list before the services.
In a separate
yes. step.
Other questions? Who knows who? Nobody? Okay, then. Thank you very much.